All right, Star Trek's back this time, the new time, 5 o'clock weekdays here on CHRO, same place. So we'll see you tomorrow for Star Trek The Next Generation. But stay tuned. Many of our new fall shows getting underway, launching tonight here on CHRO. And the new and improved package of The Early Report comes your way in just a couple minutes. Weather details and all the news of the day. Followed by, and this will be the case, Monday through Friday, America's Funniest Home Videos. Home Improvement, and tonight it's actually a specially produced Home Improvement for the syndication market, which the show is just embarking on. So that special edition Home Improvement getting underway after America's Funniest Home Videos. Janice Dean's going to be dropping by from Shea, too. $1,000 to give away. All that and the Bob Cowan Dancers and lots more, so stay tuned.
Hi, I'm Kathy Cox. Coming up on the CHRO Evening Edition, the referendum date is finally set. MPs must decide before midnight if they'll stay on the pension plan. And Paul Bernardo's lawyer can't afford to keep his client. How will government cuts affect legal aid? It's official. Jacques Parizeau today said Quebecers will go to the polls for the sovereignty referendum October 30th. Meantime, the Prime Minister said today that once Quebecers realize there is no promise of association with Canada following the referendum, they will vote no. Speaking for the first time since its release last week, Jean Chrétien calls the referendum question itself a one-way ticket to separation. CTV's Roger Smith reports.
It's a sign of Ottawa's low-key referendum strategy that the Prime Minister waited almost a week to comment on Quebec's proposal. He accused the separatists of making it deliberately vague to hide their true intent.
For me, the choice is we have to make it very clear, and it's a one-way ticket to separation.
Chrétien agreed with a judge's decision the vote should go ahead, even though unilateral independence would be unconstitutional.
There was a need for a vote, and it's very clear in my mind that it will be the last one, and of course Canada will win.
Why is he so confident the Quebec question will be settled once and for all?
Because the people are fed up, sir. I've been in Quebec this summer talking to people. They don't want to hear about it.
Chrétien was in Toronto to speak on international affairs. Though making no direct reference to Quebec, his view of the way Canada works for change in the world sounded a lot like his referendum strategy.
And we are doing it in a typically Canadian way. Quietly, competently, more concerned with results than rhetoric.
Though wary of any overconfidence that might cause their supporters to relax, Federalists are buoyed by the latest Quebec poll. It shows the Yes side didn't get much of a boost from last week's high-profile sovereignty launch, and that its support is softer. Roger Smith, CTV News, Toronto.
To take the cash or bail out? That is the question members of Parliament are debating today. If they choose, the MPs have until midnight to get out of the Commons' pension plan. Norman Federley examines the issues.
On with the wind. Reform MPs released red balloons to mark the $218 million tax dollars they say could disappear into the pension plan. 57 out of 295 MPs have said no to the pension, and even though benefits have been chopped, Reformer Deborah Gray says the plan remains seven times better than what most Canadians can get. She wants no part of it.
It's a beautiful day to opt out of $1 million.
But one reformer accepted. John Cummins of British Columbia says he needs the money.
He'll have to answer to the voters and his constituents when election time comes.
Only six Liberals out of 177 have said no to the pension. One of them, Toronto area MP Dan McTeague.
In a cynical age, people have to lead by example. I'm leading, hopefully, in my constituency by example.
Other Liberals, like BC's Raymond Chan, say they simply couldn't pass up a pension.
One need to look at the whole compensation package, and it's really unfair just targeting on the pension alone.
Fisheries Minister Brian Tobin could pull out the juiciest pension plum. The National Citizens Coalition says Tobin could get just over $3.5 million by the time he reaches age 75.
And we condemn these MPs for their hypocrisy and for their abdication of leadership.
And while Bloc Québécois MPs may want to separate from Canada, they don't, it seems, want to be separated from their pension. So far, they've all signed up. Norman Federley, BBC News, Ottawa.
Hundreds of natives and non-natives alike lined up for hours today to attend the funeral for Anthony Dudley George. He was the man killed last week by police gunfire at the standoff at Ipperwash Provincial Park. John Lees has our report.
They came from across the province and across the border, close to 1,000 of them. They came for a traditional native burial in the old army camp, reoccupied last summer by members of the Stony Point First Nation. They came to mourn the death of 38-year-old Dudley George, who was shot to death by provincial police just outside Ipperwash Provincial Park, only 3 kilometers away. They came to bury him in the Stony Point Cemetery, a native burial grounds in Camp Ipperwash. The media came too, in force, and was asked to move away from the camp entrance.
We're asking everybody to respect the family at their request and to move across Highway 21.
Gordon Peters, a regional chief with the Assembly of First Nations, said it was a day for quiet mourning. But he also said these people harbor a lot of anger towards the provincial police and that Premier Mike Harris should begin talks with these people soon. And 4 hours after they entered the old army camp, some of the people are leaving, but only some. Inside, the mourning continues. John Lees, Ipperwash.
Paul Bernardo is likely going to have to shop for another lawyer. John Rosen, who represented Bernardo at his murder trial, says he will represent Bernardo at his sentencing hearing on Friday. But after that, it's up in the air. Austin Delaney reports.
I'm prepared to go to jail if necessary. If they want to put somebody who refuses to work for nothing in jail, then so be it.
Defense lawyer John Rosen asked a judge to excuse him from a murder case because legal aid cannot guarantee he will be paid.
There isn't anybody in this country who works for nothing, and I don't intend to join to be the first. And
it also means Rosen would have to abandon the appeal of Paul Bernardo. Rosen says legal aid owes him between $250,000 and $300,000, some of it from the Bernardo trial. And last week he laid off 5 lawyers. Legal aid is in a financial crisis, $70 million in debt, and the government says it will not cover the losses, saying it's been mismanaged by the Law Society. Today, Rosen told a Toronto judge, unless he's given a guarantee of payment, he will not represent a client on first-degree murder charges and would suffer the consequences, even if it means being cited for contempt of court. The judge ruled the attorney general should pay for the defense because an accused has the right to a fair trial.
That may be one of the options that a judge has.
But Charles Harnick thinks Rosen should really take up the funding issue with the Law Society.
They are the ones that manage the plan, and if lawyers are mad about not getting paid, they should be mad at the Law Society.
Rosen argues it's the Law Society and the government who keep pointing fingers at each other, but it's the lawyers in the trenches who aren't getting paid. The Attorney General hopes to have a smaller, streamlined legal aid system in place soon. Austin Delaney, CFTO News, Queen's Park.
People could be going through the justice system without a lawyer in the future. At least that's one suggestion being made as Ontario plans to scrap the legal aid system. And until more is known about the new program, both lawyers and their legal aid clients are working in the dark. CHRO's Dave Henderson reports.
Like much of the Ottawa Valley, Barry's Bay is a blue-collar community. And many of the residents here would qualify for legal aid if they needed courtroom representation. But Barry's Bay lawyer Bob Howe says there are no longer any guarantees, either for potential legal aid clients or their lawyers. Howe is president of the Renfrew County Law Society.
Under the present system, there is this concern that the plan may have broken down to the extent that there are certificates outstanding that represent potential accounts that far exceed the funds that are available and that have been committed by the government to the plan. And certainly in the long term, there's the expressed view of the Attorney General that we can't afford the plan we have, and a much more streamlined, lower-cost plan is perhaps going to have to replace it.
Reports today hint a new streamlined legal assistance system would leave people without a lawyer in court. The report says funding would be provided only for people facing charges that include automatic jail terms. Whatever the future holds, Howe foresees a leaner, tighter legal funding system in the future.
It may be that we can no longer afford that kind of open-ended social program and that it is going to go by the boards as some of these others have, or more likely be changed or significantly cut back so that there's some definite cap on the spending and the government can maintain some control over that part of its budget.
In Barry's Bay, Dave Henderson, CHRO News.
Some positive economic news for a Pembroke company. Eddie Match has landed a contract to make 33 million match booklets for a U.S. tobacco firm. The deal means that Eddie Match will recall some of its laid-off workers. When the evening edition continues, NATO says its targets were military, but the Bosnian Serbs tell a much different story.
Sunshine for the drive home, but boy, cooler today. We're no higher than 18 degrees, but summer isn't over yet. We have a little over a week left, so you stay in those shorts, and you stay watching TV. We're going to be back with the forecast for the remainder of the week when we come back in just a little bit on Early Report.
A spokesman for NATO says the Tomahawk cruise missiles fired on Serbian positions over the weekend caused severe damage. But the same spokesman denies Serb claims that the missiles caused numerous civilian casualties. Bob Simon has the story.
The missiles were launched at the air defense system of Banja Luka, a Bosnian Serb stronghold in the north of the country. The Tomahawk was the weapon of choice because of its accuracy, irrespective of weather conditions. But NATO spokesman said safety was the overriding factor. Banja Luka is where Captain Scott O'Grady was shot down in June. And while a Tomahawk carries a 1,000-pound warhead, it does not carry a pilot. The Tomahawks were followed by a wave of warplanes which struck at the same targets and which could fly in relative safety. This was the first time Tomahawk missiles were fired in anger in Europe, but UN spokesman insisted it did not represent an escalation of the conflict.
It is not an escalatory step. It is simply a choice of a weapon that most effectively does that job, which is taking out air defense assets around Banja Luka.
The missile attack followed a meeting between Bosnian Serb General Ratko Mladic and UN Commander Bernard Janvier. UN spokesman characterized the meeting as correct and brief, but not successful, because, they said, Mladic was not prepared to comply with the UN demand.
NATO may deny that the cruise attack was an escalation, but try telling that to the Bosnian Serbs. They're claiming that civilians were killed or wounded, that power plants and water supplies were hit, that it was not peace enforcement, but an act of war. Bob Simon, CBS News, Sarajevo.
A plane carrying at least 10 members of a skydiving school has crashed in rural Virginia. The plane slammed into a house near the town of Shackelford and exploded, killing everyone on board and a man sitting on his porch.
State police say the Beechcraft twin-engine Queen Air had just taken off from the West Point area, which is a base for a lot of skydiving flights. The aircraft came down into the rear of a house on Route 606 in the Plainview area of King and Queen County. Michael Harris saw the crash, which killed his brother as he sat on his back porch two houses down the street.
I can see the plane just coming down, just wobbling like this. And all of a sudden, I just told him, my wife and kid, to get out of the way, because it looked like the plane was going to crash. And no sooner I said that, it just made a couple of flips and just crashed right in the house. Ran over and hollered for my brother, because my brother is my brother's house. And I went on to holler for Anthony's son, where was his father and where his mother was at. He said his mother was gone and his father was in the house in the patio. So that's where I went back to the patio on the back side, on the left over here. And I didn't see him anywhere.
Now federal and state investigators must find out why this twin-engine plane crashed here, killing 10 skydivers, the pilot, and the man in the house behind me. Nate Custer reporting for CBS News from King and Queen County, Virginia.
And crews worked again today to retrieve the British Nimrod jet that crashed into Lake Ontario during an air show in Toronto September the 2nd. The plane's 7-man crew died in that disaster. Beverly Thompson reports.
Twisted sheets of gray metal, sections of the plane's wings. Just a small indicator of what's left of the Nimrod sitting 65 feet down on the bottom of Lake Ontario. These pieces were pulled from the water early this afternoon. The salvage effort got underway early this morning with a 12-member diving team from Britain. Major Yvonne Desjardins.
It's dangerous to the divers because diving is a dangerous profession in itself. Furthermore, the wreckage is thousands of pieces, and they're very, very sharp objects, metal objects, and they can cut themselves very easily.
Divers will be working from a grid map constructed from the help of sonar equipment and an underwater video. Each piece salvaged will be taken to CFB Downsview, where technicians will try to reconstruct the plane. Divers are also searching for the bodies of three airmen. One was located trapped in the debris yesterday, but has not yet been retrieved. Officials believe the other two may also be found in the debris. Seven crewmen were killed when the Nimrod went down on August 2nd. The whole salvage operation is expected to take between 2 and 3 weeks. Beverly Thompson, CFTO News.
Closed captioning for the evening edition is brought to you by Arnfryer Guardian Drugs. Evening edition weather brought to you by the Ring Rose Denture Clinic.
Boy, it's a picture-perfect day in Ottawa and the Valley to report on here on the first inaugural broadcast of the new and improved early report. And I should mention, too, the Weather Center now has affordable office space for lease if you'd like to work in the nerve center. Alrighty, beautiful day today, significantly cooler though, but it does get better for the remainder of the week, but we have some wet stuff ahead as well. We'll detail all that. First up, here's how things shaped up in Ottawa and the Valley today. Lots of sunshine, but again, no higher than 18 degrees. Winds gusting up as high as 25 kilometers per hour. They'll get worse, actually. It gets ugly for tonight and tomorrow. Barometer falling 102.5 and the humidity at 46%. Now, the skies will be clear tonight, but well, we haven't got an official frost warning yet. But watch for some frost in low-lying areas as we dip down to as cool as 3 degrees for tonight and overnight. Southwesterly winds increasing to 30 kilometers per hour. No threat of any precipitation. Now, here's the map for overnight tonight. As you can see, 4 degrees for Ottawa Hull, 3 degrees for most other centers, Pembroke and Petawawa included, and most western Quebec centers. Clear skies, and it looks pretty good. All right, here's a 3-day forecast. Tomorrow, cloud cover rolling in, the high around 23. The winds are going to pick up quite a bit, too. And now there is no threat of any precipitation for Tuesday, but watch for some shower activity Wednesday and Thursday. Actually, the likelihood is Thursday, but it could arrive on both days, a 40 and 60% probability, respectively. But warmer temperatures, as you can see, for the entire 3-day, as we're up around 23 degrees. So some nice temperatures on the way. Unfortunately, not as much sunshine as today. But just as soon as we get the shower, actually, it's good that these showers arrive on Wednesday and Thursday, because they'll get out of the way just in time for the weekend. How would I know? All right, that's weather.
All right, Bob, game two of the International League Championship Series goes tonight in Norfolk, Virginia. The Ottawa Lynx lead the best of five series, one game to none. They took the opener last night 4-2. Ottawa won it with two runs in the top of the eighth. For the Lynx, it's their third straight win after coming from behind to beat Rochester in the divisional finals. Series heads to Ottawa with games scheduled for Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, if they are all necessary. Ottawa Senators kicked off their training camp at St. Lawrence University in Canton, New York this morning. Obviously, the no-shows are overshadowing the start of the Senators' fourth season. Most notable, Alexi Yashin, and their number one pick, Ryan Berard. They are both holding out. Yashin back in the Capitol, Berard in Detroit with his junior team. As for Yashin, he's been suspended without pay.
He's chosen not to be a member of this team. That's fine. That's his prerogative. He's been suspended, and it's really now time for us to focus on the task at hand. That's really to get our team ready for the season.
St. Louis Blues have suspended goaltender Grant Fuhr for failing to complete his training camp physical. Coach and GM Mike Keenan said Fuhr, who joined the Blues in July as an unrestricted free agent, arrived 30 pounds overweight. In the NFL, the Dallas Cowboys have made it official, formally announcing the signing of star cornerback Deion Sanders. Contract is for 7 years, $35 million, including a $13 million signing bonus. His start, though, could be delayed. He may need surgery on his ankle after the baseball season.
I'm not at full speed. I can't really cut. It's nothing severe. You know, I was very honest with the team doctors here, and they're going to investigate it a little more thoroughly, but it's nothing severe. It's just something, when I step foot on that field, I want to be 110%. This man has paid me a lot of money to do a job like no other, and I want to do a job like no other. I don't want to get out there and score a touchdown and dance and can't hold up on that ankle. You know what I'm saying? I want to be strong with it. So I'm going to get a scope and come here and play 110%.
Deion, what do his former teammates in San Francisco think about Sanders joining the Cowboys? Well, just listen to what Jerry Rice had to say when asked about it after the 49ers win yesterday over the Falcons.
Sanders came to this team half, it was like half
the season when he came to this team. The players who went out there and won those games should get the recognition that they deserve. The Eric Davis, Tim McDonald, Merton Hanks, all of those guys. You guys didn't give them no respect, and that pissed me off. And that's all I have to say.
NFL football is a tough game, and it's an emotional game. And it's an emotional game where you fight with the guys that are with you. And to come off the field after a 41-10 win and talk about something that's not really about that, it's a little frustrating, I'm sure, for him.
Baseball's only serious pennant race, the National League West, where the Dodgers and Colorado are tied for first. The wild card race is still up for grabs. Expos 7.5 out tonight. They wrap up a series against the Mets. Martinez looking for his 13th win of the season. The Blue Jays try to climb out of the basement in the American League East tonight at Skydome. The Jays in Detroit complete a four-game series. Paul Menhart pitching for Toronto tonight. Detroit goes in with a half-game lead on Toronto for last place. Upper Ottawa Valley Men's Basketball League Championships continue tonight in Foresters Falls. Queensland leads the best-of-seven series over Renfrew 3-1. Also trying to raise a little money tonight for the Costello family. Kirby Costello injured seriously in a car accident. The team will be holding a few different events, Kathy, tonight to help raise some money. And that is sports for now.
Thanks, Brian. There's more Evening Edition to come. Don't go away.
CHRO-TV wants to hear from you. Contact us with your news tips or about your community events by phone, by fax, or by email.
For almost 50 years, researchers have believed that men's sperm count has been dropping dramatically. But recent evidence has in fact found the opposite to be true. And surprisingly, the environmental movement could suffer a setback because of these new findings. Dr. Dina Dell has more in today's edition of the Village Pharmacy Medical Report.
You've heard the dire warnings. Since World War II, men just aren't what they used to be. Studies say sperm counts have dropped by almost 50%, and some sperm banks have been saying that more and more sperm donors just don't measure up. But now a new report took a closer look at the facts and says the numbers just don't add up.
After all, the figures usually cited are that sperm counts have dropped 50% over the last 50 years. But this new study points out sperm count data has only been accurately tracked for the last 20 years. And when you look at these numbers, they found that they weren't dropping. Instead, it was just the opposite.
The researchers were thorough. They reviewed nearly 90% of all studies on this subject over the last 20 years. Their conclusion, no reduction in sperm count. In fact, they say, if anything, sperm counts are increasing. This might not seem worth mentioning except for one fact. A lot of people have been using the so-called drop in sperm to blame pesticides and environmental poisons. In fact, the disappearing sperm factor has been a major force in trying to push through a ban of all pesticides. Well, now, it's back to the drawing boards. I'm Dr. Dean Adell.
Now, the Trucks Plus Community Happenings Calendar.
Taking a look now at some events coming up in the area. Going this weekend at Lansdowne Park in Ottawa, it's the 13th annual Fall Home Show. 300 exhibitors will have booths set up from September 14th to the 17th. In Pembroke this Sunday, September 17th, the 15th annual Terry Fox Run is being held. It goes from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. at Riverside Park. For information, you can call 735-6421. And at CFB Petawawa, September 24th, Big Brothers, Big Sisters holding the 5th annual Classic Golf Tournament. The cost is $40, which includes dinner. To register, call 735-0945. That's the CHRO Evening Edition. As part of our programming changes, we've got more local news coming your way at 11:30. Rhonda London's back with a CHRO Late Edition. Thanks for watching. We'll see you tomorrow.